Those of you that have textbooks, please take them out.
We could burn some books. There aren't enough to keep us warm.
Follow me.
Taking them off campus?
There was no place to go on campus.
You call your union rep, you're suspended.
What?
We're supposed to study in a room that's freezing, and now you want to fire one of the few decent teachers still willing to work here?
You're both suspended.
What?
When you've never had a voice.
Jackson, come on, get these kids out of here.
What are you doing, man?
Let me explain.
I don't want no explanation.
All she wants is our teacher back.
When you've never been given a chance.
Ziggy.
Put that gun down now.
You shot me in my leg.
It was an accident.
Let him go. Let him go.
This is Audrey McDonald with the New York City Police Department.
Until you step into the light.
Everybody's listening. What do you have to say?
CNN.com. This all began because of the conditions of our school.
We are not gang members as we've been portrayed.
2, students must have a textbook for every subject. 3, fix the window. 4, repair all leaks.
5, establish a career day.
Stephanie Williams, National Dean's List.
A bad hair day.
First 10 minutes, you made up in your mind who we were.
Everybody come check this out! Look,
20th Century Fox presents Usher Raymond, Forrest Whitaker, Rosario Dawson, Judd Nelson, and Vanessa L. Williams.
What did we do it for?
You stood up and you hyped up this whole city.
This might give my little life some meaning.
Light It Up, directed by Craig Bulletin.
I like to say
Look. That is Ja Rule's most slappinest song, and y'all just and I had to hear D disrespect that song. I do not like that. That is his best song ever. That talked about how many people wants to die with him, and there was a lot of grumbles in it.
Ja Rule's had probably the most interesting career when it comes to movie soundtracks because because right after that movie soundtrack, CJ, he did our favorite song. Life ain't a game. No,
yeah. First off, fuck that song. Second off, he only had the most memorable thing from that movie. Let's go, Menage, and then that's it.
A big element, a part of all of that eras about Ja Rule's soundtrack history. All of those songs. For real? Sound exactly the same.
Really do.
I was going to say not only do they sound the same, could I also say that with this movie, that we had both Ja Rule and DMX put out songs.
I mean, that happened only like five times. No shit. Like Replacement Killers, it happened on the Rush Hour album, it happened on The Wood, it happened on this one, it happened on Romeo Must Die, it happened on, not Cradle to the Grave, Half Past Dead. It happened on Exit Wounds also. It happened a lot of times.
And there was one more movie they did in that you missed. Belly.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, of course, Belly. And here's the interesting thing about all of those. If you're a white person, and I always say white person because I don't see how black people can screw that up outside of if you've never heard rap one time in your life. The song that he had always either sound just as uninteresting as DMX's song on that soundtrack.
All I'm saying is, this is a sound... One, you look at the soundtrack, and D made a good point. Somehow, this is 1999, that somehow somebody said, you know who's going to sell Gangbusters? A Marilyn Soleil on the same album.
No, you know what makes that so good? You know what makes that so good? I can tell you exactly how that went. Ring, 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 ring. Hello. Hey, what's up? Hey, what's up, Bill? Hey, Soleil. So I got a question. What is it? You want to make a song together? Hell yeah, two bitches that run the game. Yeah, I mean, we run a part of the game, like a section of the game, a corner of the game, like a small pocket of the game. You know, like a little, you know, like a block. If it was a block, it'd be like the two. It'd be the two big houses, but they run down though. Yeah, that's what type of game we run. Yeah, that's what. I'm seriously, what are they gonna do? Wrap themselves into redundancy? What the hell? Who thought that was a good pairing?
Yeah,
no, they were sliced for that song too, sir.
This is the same album, Light It Up soundtrack that has Master P and the No Limit All Stars on it, and in sync.
And look, let me make this very clear, Master P is a terrible, terrible rapper, but in some instances, he cannot do no wrong. And Hit Him Up, Light Him Up, saying it 50,000 times as a chorus is pure hip-hop genius.
him being on 4-3-2-1 was not genius, but...
Hit him up, light him up. Actually, to be honest with you, him on 4-3-2-1, I will defend it. That's one of actually Master P's best... Like 16. I'm seriously. It's serious? One of the best he's ever.
You know what it is? It throws me off. I think it's because it throws me off because I'm used to the original one. So whenever I happen, if I just want to listen to the song,
that's what happens.
And I pop it up, and it's like, oh shit, Master P was on this song. Oh man.
That's what happens with you New York loving boom bap rap loving bammers, man. But real talk. I just like to make it clear. I said it during our New Year's review. I'll say it again. Nothing brings me so much joy than to see these mumble rappers and average rappers dunk on old school rappers who are established. That is like some of the best shit I have ever seen. These old rappers who are not selling no more say something, and a young rapper says one thing and destroys whatever kingdom was left of that old rapper.
But notice the old rappers that are saying stuff, because you never hear Eminem sit there and say shit, because even if Eminem...
Let's put it this way. You're never going to get Busted to say this. Mm. You're not going to get Busted to say this. You're not going to get Freeway to say this.
Nope.
But you will get motherfucking Memphis Bleek to say this.
And let's be real about this. I like Mr. Durag Man myself, but people are going
to
dunk on him.
I would love to hear Memphis Bleek say something about new rappers. But look, we're beside the point.
Besides the point is,
you know damn well that Mr. 538 ain't gonna say shit.
True, but
he ain't gonna say shit because look. Memphis Bleek looked like a nigga that hangs out in front of Meek Mill's house to say, "Hey man, we should do a song together." Looks like a nigga.
I tell you who I don't respect: Usher's fucking damn filmography career, because that dude can't act for shit. To me personally,
Usher, Usher lucked out by having the time to do more movies than Michael Jackson, but he also lucked up of having the same acting coach as Michael Jackson.
The one time I can give him that he actually had to give a shit was when he had to play Sugar Ray Leonard in Hands of Stone. That's the only time he actually had to give a shit.
I never seen it. I can't comment on it.
He was actually he was decent as Sugar Ray Leonard. That's the only time I can give him that. The only
time. You want to know what that happens? If you watch it, it happens. And then like 2 days later, you're like, oh yeah, I did see that movie. Wow, it sucked. Remember that movie that Usher came out with where he was the DJ in the mob?
In the mix. That bullshit in movie. The mix.
Yes.
That science fiction movie.
No, that ain't science fiction, man. That ain't science fiction. That's below CW. They wouldn't do that.
Damn.
If CW does that, they like, look. No, if CW does that, it's like this. Well, the star said he'll do the movie. All right, let's just do it then.
That was one of those things where even the CW would say no.
That looked like a hard pass, like, CWS movie. When you look at it, it's like, let me get this right. Usher took a bullet.
That looked like Nickelodeon Teen Nick did that.
First off, you say that, and yet Harriet the Spy looked better looking than In the Mix. So that's telling.
Look, I say that, but have you seen Nickelodeon TV movies before?
Been a while. Been a while.
4 points. 4 points.
Yeah, I know. That was a 3-pointer plus a foul right there. 4 points, baby.
All I'm saying is light it up.
And it's funny because because Light It Up actually stars Homeboy from 4 Points.
Rob Richard, that guy has had a very weird career because...
do it right. Robert Richard.
This guy's career is weird because he had... Okay, the guy did Disney Channel original movies. He did Nickelodeon original movies. Uh-huh. You know, he was at Coach Carter.
He did straight to DVD movies.
He did House of Wax, where he was the token black dude, because he was in a couple
That was his first. I think that was his first movie he did as, like, you know, I'm doing adult movies now. I think that was, like, probably his first, if I'm mistaken.
You know, and then he did Chocolate City and then disappeared.
He was in something recently. I forgot. But
he was in The Man in 3B. God damn it, that stupid ass movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
it's like this. Put it this way. He keeps busy. He keeps busy. And to be honest with you, as an actor, I think he's underrated. I really look at him in
Lucifer.
Underrated.
So I can't say it's been a while. I saw him in Lucifer. My bad.
You know what? Also, I like that if he was white, he'll be Elijah Wood. That's the fucked up part about it. If he was white, he'd be Elijah Wood. He'll have whole lot more bigger roles going thrown, but he's black, so
I mean, because he had some movies. I think he did this movie. It was called The Feast of Something and stuff. That was supposed to be like a really I think it was based off a book or whatever. And like he got like a lot of awards off that. So yeah, I can see it.
The next thing for him to happen is he just has to light skin his way into Empire.
Man, you know, I'm surprised he hasn't already.
I'm surprised he hasn't been in a lot more stuff. I think you have, stronger, yellower, more hazy-eyed black people out there than you. You have, he got legit competition. There's that one nigga. There's that other nigga. There's Jesse Williams, Terrence Howard,
Jesse Smollett.
Jesse is not yellow enough, and he does not have funny colored eyes. Get the profile right. You just wanted to mention the gay Tupac.
First off, I do not recognize him as gay Tupac. That dude.
Nigga. Side note, if you're going to back him up, fine. I don't give a shit. But you need to recognize that he said that lie and then called himself the gay Tupac. You're going to have to live with that. That happened. All right? Like, I don't care if you like Odell Beckham. Cool. But live with the fact that nigga went on a boat and not have
won a game since then. If Odell Beckham had a stunt double, is Robert Richard. All right? Just saying.
That ain't funny. It ain't. He's too short. Also, Michael Ealy. Got Michael Ealy.
That yeah, got Michael Ealy.
Michael Ealy.
Like I said, there's actually legit competition, you know, when it comes to yellow, funny-eyed niggas. Now, you know who could be a part of that, but his eyes is not funny enough? And let's just be honest, nobody gives a shit about him. It could be Bow Wow. And I think Bow Wow actually took a couple of roles away from Robert Richard, which is a goddamn shame.
Yeah, I can name off two. Roll Bounce, that's one.
Roll Bounce.
And the lottery ticket. Lottery ticket. I can see Robert Richard playing in that.
I don't know. It's a funny thing. I didn't mind Lottery Ticket, and I think Bow Wow was the right person for that. I could actually say that. I hate Shad Moss, but I would have picked him too.
Hey, I think before Shad Moss had his breakdown and stuff, Shad Moss had an admirable movie career, and then all of a sudden he just got stupid.
I'm sorry. Breakdown? What did he do that said that's
I'm being nice, right there, D. Y'all. I'm being nice. That's me basically saying, hey, nice Shad, you're stupid. You got stupid.
Chris. You take less shit from Bryan Singer, and at least his movies come out in 4K, okay? You mean to tell me? You mean to tell me? Like, yo, man.
Can you imagine if they remade Light It Up and stuff and they got fucking Jussie Smollett playing the Robert Richard role?
No. You know what's going to happen. The second the cop pulled out that gun, he's going to shoot himself. The cop did it.
Man, first of all, I do not want to see Light It Up remade in current year.
It's gonna happen.
I will give the movie one thing. I made fun earlier when I said CW. Every time there was a good pause in the action, when they go to the next scene, here's D. Light It Up, be right back on the CW.
Hey, D, you know what I said every time there was a cut in the action for a brief moment? Now loading.
Man, listen. Okay, Light It Up is a movie that to me, there are what's certain...
What's with the filter? What's with the blue 90s filter?
Hey, time out. Hold up. Time out, guys. Our boy, Harry Gregson Williams, did the score for this movie. He's too good for this movie. How?
Like I told you guys earlier, this was Metal Gear without the Metal Gear.
Dude, like I said before, every composer does a shit thing that they have to do that's just on their record no matter what. Like Jay-Z in The Best of Both Worlds. It's there. That's not going.
So you say that and somewhere R. Kelly, me by my fighting for my life dog just pops up immediately when you say that.
Like, you're making fun of my music, fighting for my life. I didn't touch that little girl. What about that little girl? She was old enough. I mean, no, I didn't.
You want to talk about unnecessary subplots that just didn't go nowhere? I'm laughing. It's wild to me. The movie. This movie had like three unnecessary subplots. All right, well, two. I'm gonna be nice about this too. One, you have Robert Richard's character Ziggy. He's the narrator of the movie. Apparently, Ziggy is living at the school because his dad apparently beats the shit out of him. And that subplot went nowhere.
Like that. Which goes nowhere because, you know what? It goes nowhere because Forrest Whitaker makes a promise to him. I promise. Whoever does. Wait a minute. I'm sorry. You just said Harry Gregson Williams. I'm sorry. Forrest, I'm the goddamn man Whitaker. Is wasting every minute in this movie. Let me tell you something. There's one scene where he's talking about his ex-wife and his child.
Yeah.
It only lasts for 20 seconds. D, I am not bullshitting you when I say this. It is the best scene in the movie, and it makes you almost want to cry. Forrest, I don't know what he did. It was just the way he looked. You could see the sadness. You could hear it in his voice. And I'm like, dog, that $100,000 they gave you to do this movie ain't enough, dog.
Hey, dog, you know what that was, right? That was Forrest trying to show Usher how to act, basically.
Like
you notice that he was giving them acting tips because
throughout the whole movie
he's giving them tips because first of all he's constantly having to remind him that that Bishop from Juice came back from the dead. As you can see, he never died. He just transformed into Fredro Starr and immediately wanted the gun.
Dog, Fredro Starr. Okay. It's like every movie he's in, he's 0 to 100 for no goddamn reason.
Hey, Chris, you want to hear an interesting story?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it was actually Fredro Starr or it was a fan page. I think it was actually Fredro Starr. That nigga blocked me from Twitter.
What did you say? Hold up, 3BG? 3BG or yours?
Okay, if I am not mistaken, it was mine, but it probably was 3BGPodcast. Now that I really think about it,
Because this was like in
2011, my nigga.
Oh, yeah,
this
early
is where everybody was just on. Yeah, this is where it was just the end of what I call the Wild Wild West stage before we got into the racist era.
Bill Postle, no. Wild Wild West era of Twitter, like 2011 was like the last year. Yeah. Oh, if you were a celeb, you got roasted like a motherfucker. So your choice is either block the person or let it go.
Or you were really close to your fans. You don't get that. You don't get that closeness no more. You got some people that still get close with their fans,
yeah.
But there was a lot more back then. And it wasn't because of less people. Before Twitter turned into a pure cesspool. That's why.
I'm sorry. It was the savageness of Twitter and the Xbox 360 era of voice chat.
Man.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know what? I saw a meme. I saw a meme that shows... people, what was it? It was like somebody in current year that said Twitter is the most toxic place on planet Earth. And under it, and somebody wrote under it, man, this soft ass generation wouldn't last 1 second on Xbox 360 chat.
Xbox 360 chat is the worst thing in the world because that's everybody calling you nigger. But anyway, this is what happened. Somebody was congratulating him for all the good work he did on Moesha. I was like, okay, cool, whatever. And I don't know whoever it was, some nigga that was like 49 years old that had nothing to do was trying to go at me. I don't know. And all I remember writing back was something on the level, fuck Fredro Starr. He was worse than getting Onyx. I bet he gave lame dick to Moesha on the show. I like, there's nothing gangster about you. You lucky that Sticky Fingers was on Slam, or else nobody would remember that song. Also, Sticky Fingers on his worst day with a head cold, blind, can wrap a circle, can wrap you into the ground, okay? So you suck and something like that. I went on a nigga. And like minutes later, you have been blocked by Fredro Starr. So I don't care. I don't know if he even still has a Twitter page.
He does.
It was weird. Like I said, it could have been anyway. God, it's probably 3BG that got blocked.
No, actually, we didn't get blocked.
Okay, God, so it was me.
The point is, Fredro Starr's character goes 0 to 100. He's all like...
That's everything he does, like you said earlier. That's everything he does.
It's like, yo, it is like... And the fact that by the end of the movie, all of a sudden, he finds Allah at the end. He's a Muslim. Like... Well, of course.
First of all, they already alluded to that when they were showing off which I love the fact the movie did this when they were showing like the high school students that took over the school. Notice that they were showing all their damn end of the their yearbook pictures.
Yeah. You know what? Here's the thing.
I'm really sorry. When they show Usher's picture, I'm surprised it wasn't a picture of him like with his foot on a basketball or something.
Something like that, you know what I mean? With the big words 99 behind him or some shit like that. You know? Yo, the movie's premise is like this, everybody. There's a high school in the middle of Queens. It's snowy outside. There's a blue filter. Nothing's going right, all right? You see your students that you're supposed to follow. Usher, Robert Usher, who's the popular kid, Rosario Dawson, who would later grow up to be AOC and going into Congress and telling everybody to shut the fuck up and let's save the planet. What, you can't tell that's her? Because it really is her.
No, it's her.
You have Robert Richard, like we said, he's the special. You have Sarah Gilbert. Sarah Gilbert, fresh off of
Roseanne.
And if you want Dee's opinion, this is the last year that she looked any bit hot. If there's any hot, this is the last year before she goes into that weird Midwest white woman. I'm not on meth, but I look like it. Look that she goes into. Okay, so this was
can we also say that. Like for Sarah Gilbert's character, she literally recycled her character from Roseanne.
I mean, it's the same one. It's just this time it's in Queens instead of in the middle of Illinois.
And the reason why I say that is because she quite literally recycled the same. I forgot who was that wrote the movie, but they looked at her and said, "You know what? I saw that episode of Roseanne you were on. I know what to do with your character. I'm going to recycle that plot that you went through."
Hey, you know what I'm exactly saying? Do that shit. Just do that shit. Also, we have our boy Clifton, a.k.a. Caesar, man. Caesar is in the movie.
We got young-ass Caesar from freaking San Andreas.
Oh, man.
I know. I don't know that, man. You got him in the movie. And... God, I feel like we're missing one more person outside of Forrest Whitaker, who plays an off-duty, who plays a cop who was busted down, because that's what you have to be. You have to be a busted down cop to take care of children. And also, there's only one cop in a school of thousands of kids, which I got to be honest with you, police force, that shit's not cool. Just one.
Oh yeah.
Just one.
Oh yeah, D, you forgot also. One, Vanessa L. Williams, because of course she's in this movie. Oh, yeah. It's the 90s.
Of course she's in this movie. She was a part. Who's the executive producers? Kenny Edmonds and Tracy Edmonds. Yeah. She's a part of LaFace. Of course she's in this movie.
Yeah, of course. I'd say it's the 90s, early 2000s, because she was in everything. No, so it's like, all right.
No, it was. In this case, it's called LaFace.
Okay.
It's called LaFace Records. Okay, that's why Usher's the star of this movie.
Hold on, AD. You want to know what it is? This is what happens when you try to get a New Jack Swing movie to come out just after it ran its course.
Yeah, this is what happens. Actually, this is what happens when somebody has a good idea, and this is when black people say, "Oh, you know how when black people say, 'Let's make it black,' there's two ways of going about it. Either you make it a black version that's original, that does its own thing, and that's actually pretty damn good. And then there's, let's just copy this shit and try to make it way too edgelordy because, you know, that's a black and it hit me the second I seen this asshole. Judd Nelson's in this movie.
So here's the thing he plays
like the only white teacher that gives a shit, obviously. And the second I saw him, I said, wait a minute. There's the jock. There's the pretty girl who's actually smart, but nobody takes her seriously. There's the misfit. There's the other misfit. There's the gangster. Oh, shut up. Shut up. Breakfast Club, are you serious?
It's Ghetto Breakfast Club, sir.
It's a Ghetto Breakfast
Club. Though, nigga.
Hood Breakfast Club. Hood Breakfast Club.
Don't make shit for black people, man.
It's like Hood Breakfast Club, but what if they took the principal hostage, basically, except it's Forrest Whitaker.
I got mad because I thought the principal was actually homeboy that played Creighton Duke in the Friday the 13th movie, and I was like, yes. And then I realized that's the nigga from Different World. I was like, no.
Glenn Turman, nah.
I mean, there's nothing wrong with him, man. But I was like, Creighton Duke. Oh, that's not him. Oh, boo.
You know, I was just pulling so many different sources when I watched this movie. Again, the blue filter just really made me call this Metal Gear without Metal Gear. But the other thing I noticed was, did you notice how, like you said, it's like Ghetto Breakfast Club. How many times did you have to sit there and take a drink for every single time that Usher tried to pull off, "I'm being serious"?
See, he was trying to be the Ralph Tresvant sensitive guy because he had a crush on Rosario Dawson and shit. So, you know.
No. I'm not even counting that. I'm counting every single time when he just snapped and couldn't take it anymore, especially when it came to cops.
I'm sorry, that dude looks softer than fucking damn toilet tissue. So what is he trying to prove? That's my thing.
I mean, with his character, again, you know. God, Usher, you were edgelordy as fuck.
Because here's the thing. It's
he
like,
was an edgelord.
But like his character is literally...
I take that back. I don't know. It's a real coin toss between who was more edgelordy, him or Fredro.
Well, it's like... Because... Okay, yeah, but like the thing of it is, like you find out that the reason why he's kind of acting all angsty and stuff, particularly with Forrest Whitaker, is that his dad, and he doesn't trust cops, is because his dad... got shot by a cop because he pulled out a fucking like popsicle or some shit, and I'm like, God damn, that's fucked up.
You know, it wasn't even the ice cream. He pulled out a damn inhaler.
Inhaler. Mm-hmm. Here's the fucked up part. I laughed only because it reminded me of that shit from Casino. Like, he had a fucking hero sandwich, man. We shot him a fucking hero sandwich.
What fucking gun? He had a hero sandwich. Notice that they had sprinkled some cocaine next to him.
Bad too. Yo, all right. Check this shit out. You're probably you said edgelordy. This is what every time Usher did something serious, because it was so funny. Every time Usher did something serious, hits me like, that's right, and I'm going to do it my way. I'll do it my way. And I kept on doing it. Eventually, Angie's like, why you keep on doing it? Because this movie was made in 97. He really didn't have that many hits out, so give me a break. Like when somebody said, what time is it? Here's me. It's 7 o'clock on the dot. It's really easy to do with Usher. You know,
wasn't this either before or after the faculty?
This is after the faculty.
I think this was right after the faculty.
Yeah, it's after the faculty.
Because this was also right after he got Game, the movie that actually brought Rosario Dawson to the fold of, you know, people knowing who she is. So
yeah,
at least he had that. Look, hey, real quick, Harris. I mean, real. This is more for Chris. Me and Angie had a quick back and forth about Rosario, and I was like, I don't know why we let Rosario go when she does just as much as Zoe Saldana. And Angie goes, at least Rosario says she's Caribbean and she's Caribbean and all that. Yeah. Zoe, on the other hand, is like, yeah, I'm a special type of black. Bitch, you black. Shut up.
No, if I had to classify Zoe, she's in the classification that D says with black anime chicks. I really don't like black guys. I like white guys. You know, that's just what I like.
I like white people. They treat me better. Like, every time I approach my own race, and it's sad. You know, it's always a confrontation. Do you do anything to fix that situation? I'm sorry, fix? why would I want to do that? Why would I want to?
But this should be the same. This should be the same one that she go to BET Awards and she mad Drake ain't fucking filling up on her and shit. I'm like, well, you did say you didn't like fucking black guys. What the fuck you thought Drake was going to do? Nothing.
I think it's a social. It's social. It's a social standing thing. But whatever. We're not going.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but yeah.
Like what? You was expecting Drake to run up to you talking about some? He used to call me on the cell phone.
No. No, she suspected Drake to go up to, I'm sorry, nobody else over here recognize how beautiful you are compared to all the rest of these girls. Stand up. Everybody clap for her.
Now, here's the thing. D was saying about Judd Nelson being the white guy that cares for he cares for these black youths and stuff. And you know, it kind of presents something that I think in the 90s, and you know, we being part of the public school system and stuff, it's always been a thing. There's always some shit going on in public schools where something's fucked up and there's no money in it and all that stuff. Water, you know, Sarasville, and with Sarasville case, rat problems, you know, things like that, you know. It's just, these are things. And in this case, in this school, apparently...
Yeah, look at you. Oh, hey, Chris, your school. Meanwhile, Crossing, what's going on over there? You know, minor gang wars, one of the teachers sleeping with the students. I'm not fucking joking.
I think that was a thing at Sarasville. It just never became publicly known.
Hold on, guys. We're not going to spread no falsities or stuff like that. All right, guys, so stop that. Now, was the teacher white or black?
First off, I can tell you this much. She was black, fresh out of college. So you already know what time.
Fresh.
Fresh.
Fresh out of college.
You know, here's the sad part. Whatever boy she molested, his life is ruined. But the only thing guys can say, nice, dude.
Raising hand, guilty as charged.
I mean, let's just be real here. I mean, CJ, let's really, really be real here. In a way, I felt bad for her because it's like the moment she walked down, like the moment she entered the school and turned that first corridor and went down that hallway, for her, it was like walking down a hallway filled with hot dogs. I mean, because think about it, anytime that we had a substitute and it was her, nigga, I don't think I've ever seen more niggas pay attention in my life.
Woo! So, Ken Knowles, that's the Judd Nelson's character. Apparently, in this classroom, the school as a whole, they're cold as fuck. The heat ain't working in the school. So he's like, "Hey, dog, the heat ain't working. Like, these kids are cold. What do you want me to do?" And he's like, "Just take him anywhere. I don't care." Right? Takes him to the local diner to do classwork and stuff. And they're going through it, and apparently a former student rolls up there and tries to rob the place, and he talks him down. Basically,
I'm getting juice vibes.
Uh-huh. He's like, "You want some of this? Strip.
I did not appreciate how non-New York this movie actually was.
Wait, hold on. Did this place take? I thought this took place in Chicago. To be honest with you,
it took place in Queens.
Yeah, it was in Queens.
Okay. Well, it took him to
because the reason why is because when he walked in there, the fact that he said, he didn't say off the break, "I beat, take off all the hoodies, take off everything, get butt naked, my nigga. Word is gone, I killed one of you niggas." He didn't say none of that.
He did not say word is bond. He did not say run it. He did not say, he said none of that.
Really. Just regular, you know, Knowles knew who he was. And the situation went the way it went. And then the principal all of a sudden is like, "I can't believe you put the students in danger. You're on administrative leave." And I'm like, "But dude, you told them to take them anywhere." I'm like, "So
you told me to take them anywhere."
But Dawson, being a woman, had to speak up. And then the principal was like, "Fuck you. You're suspended."
I'm sorry, being a woman. Chris, you are going to get so many unnecessary comments.
That is exactly how Principal Glenn Turman was speaking to Rosario Dawson, like, "How dare you, woman, speak to me like that? Get out of here. You're suspended."
He was more like, "Bitch, you are 16.
The 60-year-old told her, like, "Hey, you did tell us to take him anywhere, so I'm just saying, dog." Like,
he's also one of those principals that has no idea who his students really are. Like, he doesn't even know their names or nothing.
Hey, well, Eris, not everybody can be Principal Barnes. I'm just saying.
Everybody can't be the principal that know everybody and care for them. Sometimes you got a principal that's only there for the ride. Only there to be in charge of people that's under him, to actually not do his work and just pass it along to all his administrators. Exactly. You know, half the principals in the country.
I'm not even saying that he's got to know the entire student body's name. I'm talking about, nigga, you know who your star kids are.
Yeah, basically, you think that.
It's not even that, because you know what? He's not even a good he's not a good principal for one main reason. Because he don't know no names, because he doesn't pay attention to his own words. You want to know why? Clearly, homeboy didn't read the script. I mean, it was sitting right in front of him. He didn't read the script. None of this would have happened.
But dude, you know what? D's right, because he freestyled on them fucking suspension thing sentences that he was handing out. Like, "Rosario, you're suspended." I'm like, "But she just told you that you did tell us." Okay, she's suspended now. And all of a sudden, Ziggy and fucking Lester. I'm like, "Yo, what? What did Ziggy do? He just walked into the fucking principal's office and he gets suspended? Like, what the hell's going on here?"
And I do like the fact that at the end of all this, my man got away without even a slap on the wrist for being an irresponsible black man.
I mean, look, of all this crap going on and all the tussling between Ziggy and Lester and all the back and forth, finally the gun falls out of Forrest Whitaker's holster and all that. And then amongst all the chaos, he gets shot. And D, because D is not shit, he sat there looking at Forrest Whitaker make the normal Forrest Whitaker look of like that. And I looked at my wife. I guess he didn't see that one, D.
I gotta be real about this. I think Ziggy was look, more.
Look. I'm sorry, Chris. I mean, hand over my eye. I guess
I might have to one up you on that one, D. I think Ziggy was afraid of the fucking slanted eye of Forrest Whitaker. That's why he shot him.
Why do we make the slanted eye like his fucking? Why do we make his eye like what's it, Sharget?
Y'all ain't shit. Well,
Shut the fuck up, though. It's Beast, though. It's Beast, look, come on. You mean to tell me. Hey, Chris, Aaron, we're talking. Look at me, DJ Sue, look at me. You mean to tell me that of all the black actors, you do not believe that Forrest Whitaker is a Hokage of all of them? You mean to tell
me? He's not an Uchiha clan.
He is not a Hokage level, all right? You mean to tell me you don't believe that? He already knows how to do it with both eyes. He just do it with a lazy eye because it's cooler.
In fact, he can actually teleport using that eye, too, as well. You didn't know that.
That is funny. Yes.
First of all, if there was anybody who was a damn ninja in this movie, it was Fredro Starr,
the reason why he, like, when Usher was telling everybody to get the fuck up out of school, the reason why Fredro don't want to go outside is because there's some niggas looking for him.
Hold on, D. Hold on, I got this. It wasn't just some niggas that was looking for him. It was the reincarnation of freaking Rodimies from Jukes.
Bishop.
For some reason, he came back. The ghost of Puerto Rican cat came back as a black dude, and because Tretch was too expensive for this movie, they had to go for his cousin.
So here's the thing: the good chunk of this movie is essentially the kids
taking a pillow. 2-3.
taking a pillow 1-2-3. Except majority of it is Lester. It's basically Usher and Forrest Whitaker talking and Usher saying, man, you a piece of shit dad. You divorced and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, okay.
When he went into dad mode, here's me. Where is any of this coming from?
Exactly. It's like,
where is any of this coming from?
You just met the dude today. What's going on here? It's like.
Fredro's character, his name is Rodney. How about when he went to go check out Forrest Whitaker's gunshot wound? He looked at him. He's like, you ain't got shit to worry about, man. Bullet went right through. It was like clean shot. He goes,
I was laughing.
I like how Forrest looks at him and goes, he looks at him and says, he's like, man, where the hell you get your medical degree from?
So
what does he do? Pulls up a shirt and says, East Riverside.
No, when he did that, when he pulls his, when he pulled up his junk, he showed all his chest and all that. Right there, I said Stairs and Queens.
I gotta be honest with you. You said East Riverside. I'm sorry. I still laugh at this part of Juice when Bishop shoots Rodney. It's like Riverside, motherfucker.
Riverside.
I'm fucking losing every time.
Y'all making way too many connections to a better movie. Stop that.
No, but here's the thing.
No, because that's exactly who Fredro Starr's character is. I don't care what anyone says. Fredro Starr was Bishop the whole movie.
Here's the makings of a 90s movie. When Kurt Loder from MTV is doing news about this fucking hostage standoff.
First of all, it wasn't Kurt Loder. It wasn't just Kurt Loder. It was MTV News, but it was old girl from MTV News.
Either way, that's when you know.
Eris. Yeah, you know that cute girl with the flat 90s white girl ass? Her.
Yeah, the one that's not Ananda Lewis.
I don't know none of them. I'm sorry. You could have said Timmy Bang Bang, and I would have believed that was one of the people. I'm sorry.
I only know Kurt Loder. Kurt Loder and Ananda Lewis. Those are the only two that be doing that. I knew it.
Say I know Ananda Lewis. I did. Wait a minute. I know she was the black girl, right? She was the black girl.
There was. Hold on. You talk about Kurt, Ananda Lewis, and for me, Suchin Pak.
Yeah, Suchin Pak. Yeah, that's the other one.
Oh, Suchin Pak. Yeah, you know what? You know, it's sadder that we as a collective have better memory of people that was on MAC Masters than we do.
Look, you're right in the fact that every black person knows Kurt Loder because Kurt Loder was the face of MTV News. It's just what it is and stuff.
I mean, and let's just be real here. I'm not going to speak for everybody, but I'm going to go ahead and say it. I wave my boomer flag with pride, okay?
I'm just saying, you know, say what you will. As a kid, regular news was local news other than, you know, the typical faces of NBC4 and all that stuff. Cool. But, like, MTV News somehow, like, Kurt Loder talking about it, it didn't come across boring for some reason. I don't know. It was just something.
I don't know. You know what it was? Because it was different.
Yeah.
It was because it was different. I think really,
no,
like,
it was MTV, a fact. If no, I remember really what it was, MTV News, what it was, it was different and it was to the freaking point.
I think so. I would say that too. It was a quick way of, you know, taking the news. I think the only thing that I will say is that when it got to the tail end of, at least for me, giving a shit about MTV. MTV news became more and more scarce. So yeah. I think that was the beginning for it.
For that,
I blame Gideon.
The fact that this movie had MTV, BET, VH1, NBC, like highlighting this Tasha standoff, I was like,
How did you like the BET show? I was like, yo, that's that new show they had that lasted like 4 seasons and nobody watched it because BT was very, very bad at advertising stuff that was good for black people at that time.
Yeah. So, you know, but
Teen Summit was barely holding on by a thread.
Teen Summit, when they stopped doing Teen Summit, I knew that's what BET said, fuck these kids. And then to be honest with you, One O Six and Park just threw a big gigantic dick in front of MTV and said we're going to take your drip and you're never going to see it back. And MTV does what every white person does when they're done with something they done sucked the life out of. Okay.
I mean, look. They sucked the life out of Carson Daly, so they had no choice but to say okay. I mean, come on.
So real talk. Did you know that Carson Daly's show was still running?
The shit came on at 1:30 in the fucking morning. Of course they were.
Let me get this shit straight. After Seth Meyers, why even watch anything? You should be ready to go to sleep or just watch more porn. So why are you still watching NBC at that
First
point?
Off, D, this isn't the early 90s where that was your only choice at 1:30 in the morning.
Exactly.
We're in 2019. You have options. You can watch Adult Swim. You could watch reruns of The Last OG on TBS.
Actually, Chris, that's where you should stop right there. You said, come on, man. This is 2019, D. There's options at nighttime now. There's Adult Swim. I'm done.
Like, there's, no, wait, hold on. There's Adult Swim, or if you really want to be extra about it, you dust off that old VHS tape that you got of old late-night BET Uncut videos.
Or you can just watch Silk Stockings on repeat and then call
or,
it a day, you know?
Or you do what every other stoner does at that time in the morning. Just get on YouTube. Be an adult. Get on YouTube.
But here's the thing. This is where the story goes into full-blown Breakfast Club. It's like, okay, they're having this guy hostage, but it goes into fucking Breakfast Club because you got Sarah Gilbert going in on Rosario Dawson like, oh, you're so goody-two-shoes, you're not like me, you know? And I'm like, okay, but you got a guy with a gun. What's going on here, movie?
And then you have Rosario had to say, I actually cherish your ideas, and I'm sorry that guy got you pregnant and left you. And here's Sarah, you know what? It's okay. I'll be fine. I'm a white woman. I can find a job like that. The world is my oyster. I'm a single white mother.
Oh, the fact that Rosario had to prove her street cred to Sarah Gilbert by saying, I stole some stuff from Forever 16. What are you talking about? I'm a thief. I'm like, come on. You didn't have to do all that, man.
Rosario, so here's me. Rosario, you Puerto Rican. Just say, I'm going down to the bodega in Spanish. That's all you had to do. And that would have shut Sarah Gilbert up.
Sarah Gilbert would have been like, oh, that's exotic. What did you say?
I don't, oh, no, you forget, this is a 90s white woman. Okay, stop it with the Spanish. I don't know what that means.
No habla inglés, okay?
Yeah.
White woman. Or, or let her break the fourth wall. God, this movie needs subtitles.
Or this, which is still there. All right, you know what? I can't wait until there's like a rich asshole that has this country and tries to kick all you people out. I can't wait for that guy to show up. He's going to make America better. See what I did? I didn't say great again. I said better.
Just make it better.
And then throughout this whole thing, you got Clifton Collins, who he's the hustler of the group. He's basically the Judd Nelson character where he's just like, I don't give a fuck. I'm just here because, you know, shit went off.
Yeah, so. Man, you know, no, actually, what I play the crazy stoner, and I do that very well, right? And all you got to do is have this moment, right, when you say something very deep and profound, and people say, hey, he's just not a stoner, man. He's actually something bigger, you know what I mean? Also, why I got a Mexican accent in the middle of New York? That makes no sense. Why nobody try to check that?
Ziggy shows everybody that, I'm an artist.
Oh, Chris, do you want to know what D said the second he went to his little cross? Hold on, before that, because before that part, for whatever reason, the SWAT team decided to roll up on them niggas and they like had to run away and go to a crawl space, right? And I was laughing because, like, yo, you mean to tell me that SWAT was so fucking lazy that they could get them kids?
Well, what it was is they were in the class, and you remember they were making demands like, hey, can we get some better books? Can we actually get some heat in the class and all that stuff?
And then the best line came from that. It was from Sarah Gilbert. And I lie to you not, this was the best line in the movie, and I couldn't stop laughing. She said, why don't you get us some life insurance? We're all fucked.
She ain't lying. It's like, well.
When she said that, I'm like, thank you, white girl. You just said the best line in this entire movie.
How's it the white girl had probably the best idea out of all of the ideas they threw out there? Yes.
I can't believe there's a bunch of brown kids from Queens, and the best idea came from the white girl. This is why gentrification is happening. We just stop producing A+ work. That's the problem.
Hold on. Your demands are, one, you want your teacher back. Cool. That's pretty much what started started this whole thing to begin with anyway. It's like, oh, you unfairly fired a teacher just because of your negligence. You told him to take us anywhere. You know? So next, you want, like, oh, fix the heat, fix the pipes, give us new books. Of all things, give us a career day. We want a career day.
Gotta be honest.
You know what the principal is saying? The principal is saying, first off, I can't turn on the heat. I can't turn on the heat. That's something I've been fighting the school system to do forever. Number two, I'm sorry about the books. That's something I've been fighting the school system forever with. And sorry for that last part. You want me to what? A career day? Let's just be real. Let's just be very real. Half of y'all are going to get pregnant or go to jail before this whole high school year is over. And number two, the ones that are lucky are either going to be working at McDonald's or playing in NFL. If my superhero type thinking is correct, by the time all y'all go to the NFL, y'all niggas won't even be able to kneel. So I am sorry that life ain't going to get no better. But I got some good news for y'all, because y'all from this section of Queens, Uncle L's coming out with a new album, y'all. So we good.
I will say this though too, the fact that before they got to the crawl space, fucking Fredo Starr was like, fuck this, here's some fire, bitch, and just threw the fire at the fucking barrier, and I was like, well.
Okay. I have one question. Where did the gas come from? Like, I'm not denying that there's kerosene or gas in the school, okay? But
janitor closet, maybe?
Why is it there?
Yeah that's
why is it there? What's the use? Outside, like I said, I can believe it's in the school, but tell me what's the purpose of it being in the school? That's all I want to know. And also, not only Not only that, but how did Fredro knew it was in the school?
Well, because a lot of a lot of groundskeepers, when they have to refill the heating system, they have to carry around a ridiculous amount of kerosene buckets.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like I said, I can believe that. I'm fine with that, but it just seemed to come out of nowhere. Like, this nigga already found the kerosene.
I know, right?
Like, you know, like this nigga be like, yeah. Like, yeah, son, been waiting on this day. I was gonna Mazel Tov cocktail the shit out of these niggas. That's what he looked like, though. I'm like, yo, how did you know that?
Dude, what made it funny too?
Well, I liked it. No, I did like it because he knew that SWAT was already in the school. That's why he had That's why he made that freaking barricade and just threw all them damn chairs and desks and shit just to block SWAT from getting in. And he's like, I know.
And inexplicably smart. Yes. Did it work? Kinda.
Yeah,
it slowed him down. It did its job.
It wasn't that it just slowed him down. They were like literally stuck and like deadlocked. They weren't trying to get through that at all. And he knew that they were there, and that's why he kept shouting from the hallway. I know y'all over there. Cause I tell you what, screams in New York. He's like, I tell you what, is you try to get through that barricade, is that I'm gonna light all y'all asses on fire. Waves
of robble. Now, when he go to the crawl space, we get to see the menagerie. We get to see the big mural that Ziggy did, and you find out that Ziggy is a deep and emoting character that has all this about him. Like, he's a special child that needs to be bright on this world. And you know what D said the whole entire time when he saw that? You're so dead. You're going to get a bullet to the head. You're so fucking dead. I was like, yo. Now it's funny for me because I never seen the movie. I never seen this movie till today. I always love it when we do a movie that I set ourselves up for, and I never watched it. Mm-hmm. So I was telling Angie right before we got to that part. Okay, the way this movie is setting itself up, somebody needs to die. One of these kids, and right when they went into that mural, he's dead. It's Robert Richard. He's dead. He's done for. The only good actor, the only actor that is actually actually a high schooler amongst all these young 20-year-olds. Yes. He's dead.
Can
we also say that that he was, like, you knew that he was dead, like, the moment you saw this side of him, because it's like, no, I know we can hide. Like, trust me, they won't find us up here.
The second he said that, I was like, oh, he's special.
The second he revealed this safe space, I'm like, oh, dude, you are so dead.
I mean,
it
didn't take them for it, because, I mean, let's be real about this,
For me, I looked at it like this. I'm like, okay, dude, you are so going to die. My only question is, how are you going to bite it?
Also, I'm not even sure on her backstory, but are you Kimberly Elise's little brother that was in set at all? Because... Yo, like this is a trap. I knew you were dead. I knew you smelled like Kimberly Elise walking through the door. I knew something was. I knew he was going to die for no damn reason.
But see, here's the thing. What wows me out about him getting killed? Okay, so I understood the aspect of the cops and them being on edge because Usher got, you know, Forrest Whitaker at gunpoint. Understandable, because that's
the fact that they got him at gunpoint. They got him as a hostage. It's also he refused to let Forrest Whitaker talk on the phone when the cops were like, hey, we just want to confirm that the man's alive. Can you do that for us, please? I'll tell you what. He says, you can get that. Give me back. Like, give me my father. Hangs up the phone.
And you probably say, what did Vanessa Williams do, y'all? All right, she was a negotiator. She's this negotiator. That's all you need to know. But what makes it even better was Forrest Whitaker said in the beginning of the movie, he's like, man, why are these cops showing up? You idiot. Man down. Every cop is going to show up for this. Y'all stupid. Like, half the time, the kids were just sitting there shocked what the police were doing. Forrest Whitaker's like, I told y'all dumbass kids what the fuck was going down.
No, but here's the thing, though.
It's like, y'all spent all that time pretending to be gangsters.
But the wild part is, okay, everybody's on the edge. They got a sniper out there, right?
Why? Yeah, and they also waited until it got very, very dramatic outside. You know, snow everywhere.
Yeah, here's the thing. Why, as a sniper, are you shooting Robert Richard's character when he had no
weapon? This is what makes it so better, because you have Usher, who has a gun pointed at Forrest Whitaker. He doesn't do nothing. And for whatever reason, I never seen him show up. He had instant transmission or whatever. Fred Joe Stark comes up behind him. Nah, man, shoot this motherfucker. And the sniper is pointed dead at both of them. I'm like, snap.
Hold on. That is why I said Fredro Starr was a damn ninja.
Hold on. It gets even more stupider, because here comes Robert Richard way on the other end of the fucking room.
Basically telling them, hey, we're good. Telling them, hey, you don't have to do this. Like, it looked like they're going to get what they want. And I'm like, okay, cool.
He's running toward them. I like the sniper. The trained sniper goes, ah, somebody's running.
I'm like, what are you
just- No. See, I know how. No, look, I already know how it's set up. First of all, the other cop, like the other detective that was with Mr. Williams, he just said straight up green light, because all he heard was the gun. He was like, hey, gun is still on Forrest Whitaker. Okay, green light. Now, bear in mind, the whole time that Forrest Whitaker is on the roof with him, my man is blocking the view of the sniper, because he sees that red dot in the middle of all that damn falling snow.
Yep.
Well, you know, because clearly Forrest Whitaker's good eye can see the actual red dot, so, you know.
And here's the funny thing about this, and it makes it so bad, though. Like I said, Robert Richard was on the other side of the damn roof.
No weapon! He had no weapon. The cop had
to make a split-second decision of seeing somebody running and then have coming up with a decision, oh, shoot him. Like, why?
You know, I'm mad that he tried. My man ran towards Usher. He gave us a better Ricky than Morris Chestnut.
He dies in the snow, and all D here is the best is yet to come for some strange reason.
hey, Robert Rosario Dawson is Otakon. He's fucking crying after Sniper Wolf got killed. Like, no!
Like, why did he have to die? Look, Rosario looks at him. Why did he have to die? Why any of this? And Usher turns around. Because I did it my way.
when he knows that he dies, right? Rosario Dawson. That wasn't even Rosario Dawson. It was your boy. Like, it was our boy Rodney. He said, "Come on, man." He said, "Why you ain't shoot him?" He said, "Why you ain't shoot the cop, man?" So you like, now look what happened. Zeke got killed because you didn't shoot him. He said, "Why you didn't shoot him? Why you ain't give me the gun? Why?" Usher turns around.
"Because I thought if we made it through this, I'd tell you.
I hate you."
Robert Richard's last words.
Since you got one on the way. Man, I'm growing and I don't know what to do.
Rashad on the ground. My man, like, Rashad. Oh, hold on. Rashad on the ground bleeding out, talking about, "There's only room for one boss and one snake."
No.
I got it for years. Here's Rosario Dawson. Huh?
I got one more. He looks as he's bleeding out, he looks over to Rodney. "Yo, you got the juice now, man."
I got enough credits.
They ain't right, because I got another one for you. When he was running over to Usher, he was like, "Fox!"
What?
Wait, the bullet was Fox dying?
As Robert Richard sits there lying on the ground, he sits there and says, I finally understand. I wasn't waiting to kill people. I was waiting for someone to kill me. A man like you. You're a hero now.
I'm sorry. I hate you. Look, I hate both of y'all. I know somebody sitting there is like, why are they making so many Metal Gear Solid
things? This movie is fucking Metal Gear.
I swear to God, you know what had me rolling? Is if all of a sudden Forrest Whitaker and Usher got into a fist fight and we get the Metal Gear Solid 4 ending and shit.
Just imagine all that happens. All of a sudden Usher gets flipped around. They both start doing CQC to each other. All of a sudden Forrest Whitaker takes out a syringe, stabs him in the neck. Usher takes the syringe, takes out his neck. F's of all, Forrest Whitaker stabs in that. All right, let's do this. Da-da-da-da-da-da. All of a sudden, it's out, and all of a sudden, the music changed. The music changed with Chaser D. You make me want to leave the one I'm with.
Oh my God, man.
They're fighting on the roof. God. No.
Hold on. So Sadiq, so what's the next song? What's the next song? Next song. Yeah. There goes my baby. And how we end it all off, Harris? Of course, we're classy. Back to the love thing. Come on, let's just get it back, man. Harry Gregson will look. We got Harry for this, man. He's going to finish the soundtrack.
Oh, so he's gonna finish it off with Old Snake. Okay,
yeah. Perfect. Yeah, Old Snake. Not the love theme song. I'm sorry. Old Snake.
Hold on. Just because I really ain't shit. When Robert Shaw gets shot, Forrest Whitaker like looks at what happens and goes, like, he did it. I didn't see that one coming. How? He plugged his controller into the other port. I could not see the future.
I guess he didn't see that one.
So here's the thing. Ziggy gets killed, and they do the whole credit the whole credits thing of what happens to the kids. The principal.
I love the fact that it's the credits without the credits. Like, we get the video game ending of the other characters.
Yeah, it's the Metal Gear Solid interlude. Like, yeah, that shit. So basically,
debriefing.
Yeah, debriefing. So basically, Forrest Whitaker basically says, hey, these kids are good. It's just a misunderstanding. And they all got a light sentence. So Lester gets 2 years in prison. And since, you know, pretty much he was the head, he gets 2 years in prison, goes to City College, aka Community College. Might as well just say that, at least to me. And then Stephanie, she goes to St. John's after doing a year in prison. Sarah Gilbert's character does a year in prison but gets released because she's having a baby, so of course.
And she's white.
She was supposed to do a year but got out early because of her kid. Went to go live with Stephanie because, you know, for damn fact she wasn't going to be living with her parents. And then after that, she just slowly
disappeared. You forgot she named the kid Ziggy.
Yeah, and then she just disappeared from everything. Our boy Caesar Villapando,
joined the military.
He joined the military as quote unquote punishment. The court system said, you know what, of all things, we're just gonna have this dude join the army.
And he was still slinging go game, man.
My man was still hustling.
I mean,
and the thing that got me was, I'm like, dude, did you just try to sell weapons to the mob?
Apparently, I mean, the military shit, because the military got money, and they're like, whatever, you know. So, you know, Fredo Starr, you know.
But we want, look, this. You just do like, hey, man, I'm going to take all this money and give it to the veterans. All of a sudden, the military shows up to arrest you. You're giving it to who? The like, veterans. It just gets arrested immediately.
Like, give it to Paulie. That's what he did.
Pay Paulie his tribute.
Pay Paulie his tribute. That's what happened. No, but see, here's the thing. It's like, and then all of a sudden, Rodney, Fredo Starr, apparently he became Muslim in prison.
Yeah.
That's what you do.
Yeah, I mean, that's good for him. 4 years later, he would be violently killed in a prison riot. All right. Okay. You're probably saying to yourself, D, that's mean. Why did you say that? I fucking hate Fredro Starr. Did I not make that very clear? I don't like him.
Also, Principal Glenn Turman was under investigation because of the situation of how the condition of the school was. And I'm like, okay, now you investigate him?
Yeah, now you're investigating. Also, real talk, it's probably less on him and more on the school system being fucked up.
But hey, blame the black man, I guess. Cool.
But whatever.
Yeah, if anything, he held a press conference and he pulled the Dave Chappelle Morgan Freeman line, which was school seems to be like school's fucked up, and somehow I seem to be at fault for this.
Yeah, and
hey, sure. I pissed off 6 kids and they took over the school and they shot a cop in the leg and one kid got killed unnecessarily. Doesn't mean I'm a bad principal, okay?
Oh, we have to also point out something here too. In the middle of all this happening, right, Vanessa Williams is the only police officer that has like is actually being reasonable, because every officer's like, yo, kill these goddamn kids. And I'm like, really? Like,
because that's what they do to you, man. That's what they do to you, bro.
I'm like, yo, everybody's like, kill the kids. And I'm like, okay, like, I get that they did something dangerous, but like, you don't kill kids. Like, what are we doing here, man? Like, you know, I don't know, man. It's not like the kids Lean on Me or the Jim Belushi movie, The Principal, where it's like, okay, I can see why you want to kill them. Okay, fine, I guess.
Bastards. Yeah, I understand that. Yeah.
These kids just misunderstood and stuff. But hey, Principal did hire back Mr. Knowles, so, you know, all was right in the world, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what? That is lighted up. I'm glad everybody came, because everybody came. I'm gonna want to die with me. How many want to die with me? How many want to die with me? How many want to die with me? Die with me. I'm sorry. That part of the beat, when I heard that the first time, I was like, yo, this shit's nice.
I think you need to make that the intro song so people can understand how hard that beat
is. Now, I got a question for you guys.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
I got a question for you guys. Do you agree with Roger Ebert, who said that the problem is that this movie was too predictable?
Yeah, he is. He's absolutely right. That is it. Because like I said, we all seen everything coming. Like, if you've seen movies long enough, and I always say that to everybody, you see movies long enough, you're gonna see same tropes get popped up. But the problem is, when the same tropes get popped up, you either have to do something with it or make it the standard good. And that's the problem. People want to either try to just copy other people, or they try to make it something new, and it just goes directly to hell. Yeah. You know what I mean? And yeah, we've seen everything come. Like, all right, she's this, he's that, he's this, he's that. I guess that part's gonna come. I guess that part's gonna come. It's like a roller coaster you've been on. You just want the roller coaster to have enough heights for you to go, ah! If you got enough of them, you're fine with the same old, you know what I mean? But if you ain't got enough of that shit, nah, hell no, man. In this movie, to be honest with you, with all the entertaining shit that was here, all of that was unintentional. It was the bad shit in this movie that made it good.
Can I be real?
So, oh, yeah. Don't read and see deep in that.
I gotta be real about this, too. This movie had no chance opening weekend because it lost out to fucking Dogma and Pokemon the first movie, so...
Man,
yeah, that is one L that this movie took.
They took a mean L. Like, it's like, Jesus Christ. And Sixth Sense was, like, on its, like, 10th weekend, too, so it's like, ah, shit. Bro.
Yeah, that ain't gonna happen.
Yeah.
That sucks.
Oh yeah, I forgot.
But anyway,
and also Denzel's the Bone Collector, so there's that. So yeah, woo. Yeah,
it has stuff to go against. But anyway, next week we are introducing everybody to something that we all are scared of when it finally shows up in front of your house, roaring at you like a lion, or you know, or staring at you with bad CGI effects. Twister.
Yeah, Twister. White people's kryptonite. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Bye. We see y'all next week.